Okay, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody, depending on where you are all over the world. I'm Fabrizio Palmisa. Yeah.
We can wait. They are slowly entering. Maybe we just wait that we have all the participants because the number is increasing.
Ah, okay. To all participants, let's wait for a couple of minutes because there are many people entering in the webinar.
Maybe now it's stabilized. Probably we have all the participants.
Let's wait one more minute. Yeah, they're increasing. There should be more. Okay, I think we can start. Okay, hello everybody, I'm Fabrizio Palmisano. I'm the director of PPE Consulting based in Bari, South Italy, and research fellow at Politecnico di Torino. I'm here as vice chair of the Italian group of IAPSI and the member of task group Forensic Structural Engineering 5.1 of the IAPSI, which are the organizer of this webinar. And I'm very pleased to moderate this webinar with Professor Claudia Vitone. The key lecture will be given by Professor Carlo Vigiani, but we will have two introductions by Professor Limongelli and John Dantman. The special lecture that is on the Leaning Tower of Bridges, you all know, will be included in the forthcoming bulletin of the IAPSI that will be published next year on case studies on failure and failure of investigation in structural and geotechnical engineering, which will include more than 15 cases of failures and collapses. Quick, some instruction for this webinar. This webinar is being recorded and is being telecasted live. Later, this video will be added to IAPSI Learning website. All technical questions should be posted under the Q&A section and please not under the chat. And there will be, as you know, a final discussion and Q&A session. And please, so I will strongly encourage all of you to interact live with the speaker by posting your questions. So let's start immediately with the first introductory presentation by John Dantman. John Dantman is a senior principal at WIS GenES, the associate consulting company based in the USA, and is here as former chair of the task group 5.1 forensic structural engineering. John, the screen is yours.
Thank you, Fabrizio. I'm just going to talk a little bit about IAPSI here to preface the presentation by our speakers today, just to mention our mission, which is to exchange knowledge and advance the practice of structural engineering worldwide. IAPSI currently has over 2,500 members in 100 countries. Some of the deliverables or work product that we produce as an organization are publications, which include journals, the Structural Engineering International, which I hope many of you are aware of and have had the opportunity to review, the IOPC bulletins, which Fabrizio just referenced, the upcoming bulletin on forensic engineering failures, I hope you will all find interesting, and also conference proceedings. We have two conferences per year, or two international conferences per year, and the proceedings and papers from those conferences are published. This presentation today is sponsored by the Italian National Group in cooperation with Task Group 5.1. And we have, as I indicated earlier, over 100, IOPC is represented by over 100 countries or operational within 100 companies. And we have a very, very good international group. The real work product of this organization is the task groups. And currently we are organized under six technical commissions. And within those commissions, there's subgroups or task groups like 5.1. And the basic commissions are performance and requirements, conceptual design, structural analysis and evaluation, construction methods and processes, existing structures, which is our group is part of, and sustainability. Again, we have very active national groups and conferences, both international and national conferences, a couple times a year. We just completed the IOPC, just kind of a look ahead here. We just had our annual fall congress in Nanjing 2 weeks ago. Upcoming events, next year, there'll be the, in April, there'll be a long span bridge conference or symposium in Istanbul. And next fall, there'll be the annual conference in New Delhi. Abstracts for the New Delhi conference are still open, and the deadline to submit those abstracts is October 14th, I believe. We also have a very active student program or young engineers program, which includes free online access to the SCI journal, reduced IOPC conference fees, free eBooks, monthly newsletter, discount on publications, and at all of our congresses, there's a great young engineers program that I would encourage all of the young engineers that are participating today to try to attend. Just a couple of short notes on the activities of our group, TG 5.1 on forensic structural engineering. As Fabrizio indicated, I am the recent former chair of 5.1. The vice chair, Carl Terrell, has stepped into the position on this next term, which will be over the next 4 years. And Laurent Russ will be the vice chair on the next term of TG 5.1. Our primary mission is to mitigate structural engineering failures by sharing knowledge and to enhance the improvement of structural engineering practice. Our current action items, which we hope to complete over this next year, 4 year term, is an ongoing project to report on forensic practices throughout the world, organize webinars such as what we're having today, having pre-conference workshops, virtual and in person once we start the congresses are more actively or more in-person events. The publication of SED practice forensic engineering case studies. There will be a special issue of forensic engineering published in SCI tentatively in the fall, in late 2023 or early 2024. And we have a website where we actively post digital information. So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Fabrizio to introduce our speakers.
Thanks a lot, John, for your introduction. The next speaker is Professor Maria Pina Limongelli. She is Associate Professor of Structural Engineering at the Politecnico di Milano. She is a chair of the Italian group of IAPSI and vice chair of the IAPSI Learning Board. And so, Maria Pina, the screen is yours.
Thank you, Fabrizio. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm very pleased to introduce the newly formed IAPSI IT group, which is the national Italian group. It already existed, but we have a new asset now. The mission of the group is consistent with, of course, the mission of IAPSI International, which is to advance knowledge and the practice of structural engineering worldwide. And this covers several aspects in structural engineering, material, and all the life cycle aspects of, civil structures mainly. The Italian National Group currently gathers 70, almost 70 active members, but we hope in the next months to increase this number. Go on, please, Fabrizio. We are building, organizing ourselves with several activities. We are creating technical task groups to discuss on specific topics, and one of our mission will be to disseminate the activities of the task group in the same way as John just discussed for the international association. So papers on the Structural Engineering International Journal, IAPSI Bulletin, workshop, special sessions, and webinars like the one we organized today. And of course, we plan to support the organization of training activities of different types. And we also have a young members group with a very active chair. And the conditions are the same to join, in this group are the same, of course, as the International Association, so to be younger than 35 years old. And the idea is to exchange knowledge between the young members, but also non-members that are very welcome to join. The last slide, how to join. You can, for example, join the LinkedIn page, iapsi.it, and you can use this code to connect to the page. And you can also contact us, me or Fabrizio, who is the vice chair of the Italian group, to join one of our task group. In the next weeks, you will find news about the working group that we are creating. So if you are interested, you are very welcome to join. And this, I guess, is all on my side for what concerns the IAPSI.it. But as Fabrizio mentioned, I'm also involved in the e-learning board. The e-learning is a group, an activity by IAPSI related to everything that can be, disseminated through the web. All the webinars like the one you will attend today are telecasted and uploaded on the website, so you can just browse our page and you will find several webinars on almost any topic covered by IAPSI mission. And I really invite you to have a look because I'm sure you will find several important, you will find important, interesting inspiration for your activities. Okay, yeah. Now I back the word to Fabrizio.
Thanks a lot, Maria Pia, for this introduction. So I will introduce very quickly Professor Claudia Vitone. She's Associate Professor at of Geotechnical Engineering at the Politecnico di Milano. And
Di Bari.
And she's the right person to moderate with me this webinar. The topic of this webinar is the interaction between geotechnical and structural engineering. So we need an expert in complex soil, such as Professor Claudia Vitone. So I will give the screen to Professor Claudia Vitone to introduce Professor Vigiani.
Good afternoon, everyone. Do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I'm very honored to be here with you. Also because I'm with Carlo, perhaps we are the only geotechnical engineers surrounded by a lot of structural engineers. And so this is a miracle that Carlo can do. And I'm very happy to be here with you. Carlo Vigiani is an emeritus professor at the University of Naples, Frederick II, Federico II, where he had been teaching foundation engineering for more than 34 years. I want to underline that his book on foundations is on the desk of almost always all the geotechnical and structural engineers in Italy. He is co-author and author of five books, more than 200 technical and scientific papers. He has been editor of the Italian Geotechnical Journal, and he is component of the editorial board of the Journal of Numerical Analytical Methods in Geomechanics, which is a Q1 journal in our sector. He has been state-of-the-art reporter at the worldwide International Conference of Soil Mechanics and Foundation Engineering in New Delhi in 1994 about the mitigation of natural hazard, and at the International Conference of Soil Mechanics and Geotechnical Engineering in Japan in 2005 on Pile Foundation, where he is really a worldwide expert. He has been chairman of the Technical Committee 19, now 301, about the preservation of monuments and historic sites of the International Society of Soil Mechanics and Geotechnical Engineering. And as you will see, as in this case is emblematic, but he participated to the conservation of a number of monuments affected by geotechnical problems. He has been involved in the design and construction of several really crucial works, such as air dams, civil and industrial buildings, bridges, tunnels, always very complicated issues, and underground construction, stabilization of landslides. He has been consultants for Italian railways and underground transportation systems in Rome, Naples, and several other towns in Italy. He has been involved also in the design of the suspension bridge over the Messina Straits, which we hope, I don't know if I would like to have this bridge, but however, he was involved in this design, which is a real challenge. I would also like to underline that he published it, because I know that there are some of my students, Italian students, he wrote a very fascinating book in Italian, unfortunately, on this experience of the Tower of Pisa. And I would like now I'm going to conclude just to add that he is one of my best friends, because he learned and make me fascinating also towards geotechnical engineering. You will see he's an incredible speaker. I will leave you now the floor, Carlo. So happy to be with you this afternoon.
So it's my time. Thank you very much, Claudia. I am very honored to be your friend. And first of all, I must apologize for my English. My English has been always terrific, but the long interruption due to COVID and my very old age have made my English, I am afraid, practically understandable. I rely on two points. First of all, I try to write most of the important statement on my slides. And second, I rely on your very bright intelligence to understand me. But let's go on. Okay.
Okay, we see it. Okay.
Yeah, presentation mode. Great. Thank you.
Now, the title of this presentation is Without Even Touching It. And it deals with the story of the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Why the title say Don't Touch It? Because as you know, as you can understand, when dealing with building or problem involving cultural heritage, the engineer, besides preserving, guaranteeing the safety, has to preserve the integrity of the monument, of the building, of the environment. Now, generally, the preservation of heritage is associated to restorers, to art historians, to archaeologists, to structural engineers, but there are also the geotechnical engineers. And to support this statement, I am presenting the famous case history of the Tower of Pisa. Now, the monuments in Piazza dei Miracoli in Pisa, the cathedral, the baptist, the tower, have been erected, is the tower by night. This monument has been erected in the Middle Ages. That was the period of maximum splendor of the Republic of Pisa. And this piazza is a stupendous manifestation of the unity among religious, spiritual, and political powers. So that from the very beginning, the history of art and the civil history intertwine strictly, giving those monuments a character of a sign and symbol of the city. But let's go to more technical question. This is a section of the tower in the north-south plane that is very nearly the plane of maximum inclination. You see some data about the dimension and weight of the tower, but I want to call your attention on two points. The first one is the excavation around the tower. This excavation that in Pisa is called the Catino, that means the basin, has been dug in the 19th century because the base of the tower was buried into the soil due to a settlement of at least 3 meters. Second point is that the axis of the tower is not a straight line. It has a so-called banana shape because it is carved with the concavity toward the north. And this shape is due to the correction made by the mason during construction to counteract the inclination that was already developing during construction. At the beginnings of 20th century, there was the sudden collapse of the San Marco Bell Tower in Venice. And this collapse called the attention of people, of authorities and of public opinion to the Tower of Pisa, so that there was a start of a systematic geodetical survey, and they discovered that the tower was still moving, the inclination was still increasing. This kind of problems, very difficult, in Italy are typically dealt installing a commission, typically dealt but rarely solved installing a commission. And between 1908 and 1935, there were a number of commissions dealing with the Tower of Pisa. One governmental commission proposed to fill the Catino with concrete. Luckily, this solution was rejected in Pisa, and Pisan formed the counter commission. Then, as always in Italy, the things smoothed out and there was a new government commission, including Pisan members. And this commission decided to postpone any stabilizing action after water tightening the Catino. I omit to remember that the Catino was deeply into the water table, so that it filled with water, and it was necessary a continuous pumping that was believed to be very dangerous for the tower. Sorry. This is a scheme of the injection of cement grout in the foundation of the tower that have been associated with the chemical injection in the soil around and below the Catino. Now, then the World War II stops all the activities, but at the end of the war, it was evident that the injection performed in 1936, incidentally, it was the years of my birth. this injection have stopped the flow of water, but they have not stopped the movement of the tower. In 1965, the N Commission, there was another very important commission called the Polvani Commission from the name of its chairman, that was in charge of calling an international tender for design and really and implementation of the stabilization works. The Polvani Commission for the first time included a team of geotechnical engineers. You see here a photograph with Professor Alan W. Skempton, famous for which geotechnical engineers is like a very important person. This Professor Croce of Napoli University, my mentor, Professor Schultz from Aachen, Professor Cestelli Guidi from Rome, and two young docs boys, I would say, Professor Giovanni Calabresi, doctor at the time, Giovanni Calabresi, and Dr. Carlo Vigiani, very, very young in that period. This commission, this Polvani Commission, carried out a very important and exhaustive investigation, for instance, on the history of the tower, for instance, on the structure of the tower, but for what is important today, on the subsoil. There were 27 groups participating to the competition. 11 were admitted, 5 projects are pointed out as worthy of consideration, but at the end, no contract was awarded. Then everything was always slipping. 30 years later, this is the Civic Tower of Pavia in Northern Italy. And this what has the collapse that happened in 1989. And this collapse again called the attention on the Tower of Pisa, so that in 1990, it was installed the 18th Commission, an international committee for the safeguard and restoration of the Leaning Tower of Pisa. And this committee had the task not only of conceiving and designing, but also of implementing the stabilization works. The committee was a 15 members team, including restoration, history of art, archaeology, petrography, structural engineers, but also geotechnical engineering this time, engineers. And here you see the committee. Professor Michele Jamiorkowski was the chairman of the committee, is a geotechnical engineer. And you see Professor Vigiani is slightly older than in the previous photo. Sorry. You must excuse me, I am not very clever with these infernal machines.
Don't worry.
So this international committee is very similar to a pool of doctors at the bedside of a very sick person at the point of death. And it is evident that before any action, any therapy could be implemented, it is necessary to formulate a diagnosis. Now, a diagnosis in medicine is based on three elements: an anamnesis, an objective examination, and an instrumental examination. So the anamnesis is the collection of all the information available. And in the case of PISA, there were a lot of information, most of them saved in the documents and investigation of the previous commission, essentially the Polvani Commission. Then there were some geodetic measurement of the inclination and the history of historical data. For instance, this is a fresco in the Camposanto in the cemetery of Pisa showing the translation of what is important that you can see the tower. And this is datated 1385, and you can have at least an approximate idea of what was the inclination of the tower at that time. Then you have some documents, for instance, three or four centuries later, Vasaris writes that the tower inclined at the side to sit leans 6.5 braccia. It means that the leaning cannot measure the braccia, that is a length measure. It is the outer plant. So it is possible to reconstruct the history of the tower. The history started in 1170 and in 3 years reached the fourth order. Then there was a stop, and this stop went for one century. Then it started again, and the tower was practically finished, but except the bell chamber, and another stop of 90 years, and then finally the bell chamber. I am so sorry. Now, the objective examination essentially was concentrating on the banana shape, because from the banana shape, it is possible to reconstruct the inclination of the tower during construction. For instance, you see that when the bell chamber was constructed, the tower had moved for one century, and it was necessary to introduce a very important correction. At south, you have 6 steps. At north, you have only 4 steps. So this difference of inclination between the bell chamber and the body of the tower can be seen also by naked eye. The history of the inclination may be reconstructed. These are the three phases of construction, and these are the inclination as reconstructed from the banana shape. They are very reliable. At the beginning, the tower inclined to north and then to south. Then we have measurement starting in 1817, two English architects, Crazy and Taylor. Then in 1859, a French architect. And then the modern measurement. In between, we have some indication. For instance, the fresco that we have seen, the indication by Vasari. So you see
Professor, I think the presentation stopped. You have to scroll the presentation.
Excuse me?
We, no, non vediamo avanzare la presentazione.
In questo momento è ferma.
Noi vediamo objective examination, gli scalini differenti a sud e a nord.
Ok. Adesso è avanzata?
No.
No, no.
Forse conviene togliere la condivisione e rimetterla.
Sì. Ora è avanzata.
Si sta muovendo, ok. Adesso siamo su History of the Inclination.
E ora? Adesso siamo History of Inclination.
Sì.
So you see, this group of points are very reliable coming from the interpretation of the banana sheet. These are modern measurements, very reliable. In between, there are indications. But what is clear that at the beginning of 19th century, the towers was practically motionless, or at least it was moving very slowly and with a decreasing rate, so tending to an equilibrium position. In at mid-19th century, there was the excavation of the cathedral. The excavation of the Catino was very bad, produced a sudden increase of the inclination, and the progress of the inclination after the excavation was more rapid and was with an increasing rate, so tending undoubtedly to a failure. Si è mosso? Allora, instrumental examination. The instrumental examination first of all, consisted in a very good subsoil investigation. These are some of the investigation made in the plane of maximum inclination. But schematically, the subsoil of the tower consists of a thick layer of soft to medium clays from 10 to 40, about meters of depth. As a surface horizon of 10 meters depth of recent alluvial or lagoonal soils, so very intricate layering of sand, silts, and clays, and below 40 meters of depth, essentially stiff sands. What is very interesting is that this layering, as is typical in a coastal plain like that of Pisa, are very, very horizontal. On the area of the Piazza dei Miracoli, these planes are horizontal with a deviation of a few centimeters, except below the tower. Below the tower, there is a depression that is clearly due to the weight of the tower, and the depth of this depression is more than 2 meters. And adding to these 2 meters, the compression of the soil between the base of the tower and the top of the clay, we get an estimate, a very reliable estimate of the settlement of the tower. That was at least 3 meters, probably more. Let's skip this groundwater. The modern measurement of the inclination made by different means show that the inclination is steadily increasing. Not only it is steadily increasing, but correcting for some accidental increase, for instance, for the increase due to the grouting. I am sorry. Not only my English is very bad, but also my ability. Yes, you see, not the correcting this trend by the occasional increase, we discover that the rate of rotation in the 30s was 4 seconds per year. And in the 90s, it is 6 seconds per year. So the rate of rotation is steadily increasing. Then we performed a very careful analysis of the available data on the movement of the tower. And going into the details of this measurement, we were able to understand that the tower is not subject to a differential segment, as it was believed till now, but it is subject that the kinematics of its movement is a rotation without a translation, a rotation around with the center of rotation that is more or less this point. So rotation without any settlement. These kinematics is consistent with the phenomenon called leaning instability, which is not due to a low strength of the subsoil, but a low stiffness of the foundation soil. To model this phenomenon in a very simple way, we can refer to the inverted pendulum. Inverted pendulum is a rigid body with a concentrated mass at the upper extremity and vinculated to an elastic hinge to the basis. So that if you move when it is vertical, it is in equilibrium because also the gravity act in the vertical direction. If you disturb this equilibrium moving the pendulum, you generate an overturning moment that is more or less weight W for length of the body for the rotation, and the stabilizing moment due to the spring, so that you can have that the stabilizing moment exceed the overturning moment at the pendulum gas back to the original vertical position. If the contrary occurs, the pendulum collapses. If the two moments are equal, the pendulum stays in the displaced position. So you can define a factor of safety that is the ratio between the stabilizing and the overturning moment. In the reality, the rotation moment curve of a foundation on clay, these are the results of model testing in centrifuge, is of course far from linear. And this, you see that there are an influence of the normal effort. You see that there is, if you unload and reload, you get a much stiffer behavior. So typically this is a behavior that is a nonlinear elastoplastic. Okay. What is very interesting is that when you go on an unloading reloading bench, the stiffness of the rotational spring increases very much. And so this increase can be used to increase the safety factor of the tower. So the idea was to decrease slightly the inclination on the tower to bring the tower on this unloading reloading bench. We decided to reduce the offset of the tower by 40 centimeters compared to the total offset that is more than 5 meters. And this differential settlement is obtained acting on the soil, on the foundation soil of the tower, without touching the tower. So it is perfectly respectful of the integrity of the tower, of the material, historic, iconic, and so on, integrity of the tower. We have considered different way of inducing this different settlement: a surface loading north of the tower, a shrinkage of the clay by electrosmosis or by vacuum pumping, or the controlled removal of small volumes of soil below the north edge of the foundation. We called it under excavation. All these techniques have been explored. We spent 4 or 5 years doing physical models at small scale at natural gravity and in centrifuge, field model at large scale, numerical analysis and so on. At the end, we followed the alternative suggestion of Chamki Baban, a girl 9 years old of Bangladesh, transmitted to us by the UNESCO in Paris, as you see, and we decided to use the under excavation. We started with a large scale model test, scale 1-3, more or less, performed in a place in Piazza dei Miracoli. So you see, we constructed a circular foundation, eccentrically loaded by weight. And then we did some under excavation experiments. We installed the pressure cell at the contact between the foundation and the soil to see what happens to the contact stress. The procedure was that of excavating with an auger inside the tube and then extracting the water and then returning it back, leaving a cavity in the soil that closes. Angioplasty, to stay in the medical comparison. And we did these experiments on this small scale test, and it worked very well. So we had to go to the tower. We had no choice. We should go. It's strange to say so. We should have been very glad of it, and we were very glad, but also very worried of the response. In any case, we installed a safety provision, two cables, steel cables, 100 meters long, more or less, with some weights on the other side that can apply to the, they are not fixed. They can apply a stabilizing moment if needed. And so you see this particular of this machine, is the installation of the steel cables. And this is the holes that we did. And the under excavation was limited to this part of the hole. You see this photo taken from the tower, the preliminary under excavation. Just to test it, was performed with 12 holes. And it was very successful. We succeeded in diminishing the inclination of the tower of 120 seconds. We could remove three. I forgot to say that before this, we had installed a counterweight of lead weights to stabilize the tower. We will see it in a moment. And so we passed to the final under excavation with 41 holes. You see here the steel stays that are already in place. And this is the drilling machine during the under excavation. This is the soil coming out. And here you see the lead ingots that we had put on the north side of the tower to stabilize it. And you see that in year 1999 and 2000, we succeeded in decreasing the inclination of the tower of about half a degree, 1,600 seconds. You see that this strange shape of the tower. Don't worry, it is only that this was the month of August, and in August, work people was in on holidays in Italy. So we gradually removed the lead ingots, and you can see that on January 201, the last ingot was removed. If I could zoom on my face, you would see a smile because everything went very well. You see, this was the inclination of the tower. We have already seen it from the construction till 1990. Then this is the under excavation. And you see that practically our under excavation compensated the negative effect of the excavation of the Catino. And in my opinion, it is there is a sort of poetic justice in the fact that the bad, the terrific effects of an excavation very uncareful was compensated with another excavation, this time well done. So this is the detail of the movement of the tower after the, for the under excavation. You see the under excavation was finished in 20,000 and then the tower went on moving gradually, always northward. These are not the very last measurement, but you go, the measurements are going on this way. This intervention practically cannot be seen at Naked Day. Here you see two photographs taken before and after the excavation, and you see that this column has moved a little bit toward the north. This is the abscess of the cathedral, this is the tower. So the effect under excavation is the movement from that position to this position is practically nothing. So the iconic, the formal integrity is saved. What will happen in the future? Many people, the typical engineers, I must admit that I am very familiar with this way of reasoning, said, but we should have put piling below. Now, what we have done is not to solve the problem, but to have transmitted it to the future and so on. We tried to extrapolate this trend in the future, but the time interval is very short. So we had only the possibility of individuating a field bounded by two trends. The optimistic trend is this one. In this trend, the tower approaches a stable situation and then it stays motionless. It's what all we hope. But the more pessimistic trend is that at least 10 years from now, the tower will move again southward. We call it the honeymoon, this period. The honeymoon will be interrupted. The tower goes south, first very slowly, and then with increasing velocity. We have computed very carefully that in this case, the tower would reach the position it had when we began to work in a time of the order of 2 to 3 centuries. So there is no problem in 1 century from now, if the monitoring shows that the tower is going toward a dangerous position, to repeat a small under excavation intervention. And this is also very, very close to the medicine. After an operation, you have to monitor the sick person, and if necessary, to intervene with some further intervention. This experience of the Tower of Pisa has been a fantastic experience. It's the most nice and intriguing adventure of my life. But we have learned a lot of lessons. I want to call 3 lessons fundamentally that have impressed me. The first lesson is that the ancient Pisan employed 2 centuries to construct the tower, and they went on with braveness in spite of the fact that the tower was inclining below them, and they finished it. The modern engineers, as a challenge, obstinated in saving the tower
And they also spent almost two centuries of attempts, starting from the excavation of Dicatino and so on. And they succeeded, in my opinion, in stabilizing, in saving the tower. So the first lesson is perseveration, persevering. Second lesson. We have now at our disposal a very satisfactory numerical model. Satisfactory, I say, because it describes very well all the history of the tower. It has been tested and in some way calibrated against the history of the tower. And we had the idea of saying what would have happened if the Mason did not change the shape of the tower, but if they constructed it straight. And very, very, how to say, surprisingly, if they did not the correction, the tower would have been much better. You see, instead of being inclined of more than 5 degrees, it would be inclined of 4 degrees. So the correction during the construction made to save the tower and producing the Balanchine have been actually detrimental. We have already seen that the excavation of the Catino has been very, very, very detrimental, but also it was done to improve the look of the tower. So the second lesson is that the way to hell is paved by good intention. Good intentions are necessary, but by far they are not sufficient. Sometimes the history of the tower is rich of examples. Third lesson. We have seen that during the history of the tower, we had two long interruptions. These interruptions, if you made a computation of the beam capacity of the tower in undrained condition, in this configuration, you discover that it is on the verge of falling. The tower is on the verge of collapsing for a rupture, an undrained rupture of the coverage. This 1 century stop produced a consolidation of the clay and an increase of strength, allowing the construction of the second step. And again, in this condition, the tower is on the verge of collapsing, and again, 1 century of stop has allowed the construction of the belfry. We geotechnical engineers were enthusiastic when we discovered this, imagining that the old Mason had an idea of theory of consolidation, mechanics of multi-phase medium, and so on. It's not so. The interruption are due to different reasons. Are due to political, economical reasons, but they happened in the right moment. Again, applying our finite element model, if the tower had been constructed without any interruption, it had filed many centuries ago, before reaching the end of construction. But there is another history that is very interesting. In 1944, in July, Pisa was the line of the front. At south, there were the American advancing. At the north, there were the Germans resisting. And every bend of road, every farmhouse, every escarpment seemed to be occupied by a group of bomb-stinted Germans. The American said, but how do the Germans in this very flat terrain know where we are? So they, at that time, there were no drones or satellites and so on. So they must have an observation point, maybe the tower. So they sent Sergeant Leon Weckstein with the binocular near the tower to say if there are Germans on it. If was detected an enemy activity on the tower, the American was ready to distract it. There was a ship with his guns just out the on the sea, out of the coast at 10 kilometers, ready if Weckstein gives the signal to destroy the tower. Americans were not going to sacrifice men for a chunk of masonry, no matter how Americans are very practical. This is Sergeant Leon Weckstein when they reached the tower. This is Weckstein many years later, and he wrote a book, a memory book on his wife, To My Years, the 91st Infantry Division in the Italian campaign. And what writes Weckstein? What the 91st Infantry Division did not know was that they were entrusting one of the worst, most fearful missions to a man rejected by the Navy for being short-sighted. In 1942, the Navy had told me to go and eat carrots for 6 months. Then infantry took me, that they take everyone. So again, I must say that most major undertaking rest at least partially on the effect of casual favorable circumstances. So that the third lesson for a Neapolitan like I am, may be the most important, is that a modicum of good luck won't do any harm. Thank you very much. And again, sorry for my very bad English.
Thanks a lot, Carlo. We have just lost Professor Vitone. Maybe she's having suffering from some problems with connection, but anyway, thanks a lot for this fascinating lecture presentation on the Leaning Tower of Pisa. I would say that I have listened to Carlo talking about the Tower of Pisa other times, and every time I'm learning something more. And I would also take the occasion to thank Carlo for the chapter that he has already written for the forthcoming books on failure case study that will include also this very useful lesson learned that you have described at the end of your presentation. I appreciate it. Especially the last one, a modicum of good luck won't do any harm, I think is one of the most important things because we as engineers, we need the good luck in our job in many cases, I would say. So I would encourage all of you, all the participants to write questions in the Q&A session. And I have a quick question for Professor Vigiani. This case has been a successful case of interaction between structural engineers and geotechnical engineers. Can you comment on that? Can you talk about a bit about the structural engineers that were developed and interaction with them, because it's not as simple as usual, the interaction between geotechnical engineers and structural engineers.
I must confess that my relation with the structural engineers is very complicated. For starting, I did my doctor, my thesis with Professor Gian Greco on structural matter, on the concrete dam with double curvature. So, but later on, I went to Geotechnical Institute in Napoli, and I discovered that at that time, I refer to the 60s, at that time, the geotechnical engineers were in the academic body as the professor of physical education in the school. They are the last arrived people. And they, especially the structural engineer treated them with one of my friends, a structural a professor of structural engineering, said to me, Carlo, but we have already done the foundation. Now you come and you want to do the view, but we can do without you and so on. So during my life, then the structural engineers have gained some space and now they are, but this starting point is always present into me. When dealing with the Tower of Pisa, we had structural engineers in the commission, and they initially wanted to do very important reinforcement, strengthening intervention on the tower. And I was continuously saying that they want to do it just to be very important, but they were not needed. And so there was a terrific war. At the end, they did only some circle, they involved the steel cables around the tower to reinforce it. And this cable are, of course, of stainless steel. And they were strongly against, and I said that this stainless steel will be like the paillettes of the femme, of the women and so on. And they said to me, don't worry, they will oxidate, but it is inoxidable steel, don't worry. Actually, they have oxidators, I don't see. So it's a symbol of the peace between geotechnical and structural engineering. Of course, the Tower of Pisa had a lot of structural problem, and also, for instance, we had the problem, do the column of the tower participate to the static behavior of the tower? Most of that column have been changed during the centuries and so on. And the structural engineers had a very bright idea. They measured the vibration period of the column that is strongly dependent on their vincles, their boundary condition. And we discovered that all the columns are collaborating to the behavior of the tower. And so, as it is obvious in a multidisciplinary problems, each one can give a contribution.
Thank you. Thank you. John, you have a question.
A question and a comment. First of all, Professor Vigiani, thank you very much. This is an excellent presentation. And I just wanted to say that your English is better than my Italian. So it's very good. But I was having some problems with the Q&A block here. I just did have a question of, did you predict, or were you able to kind of predict what the ultimate amount of displacement necessary to for collapse of the Tower of Pisa, and what was kind of the variability of that, or how reliable is that estimation?
The point is not easy because it involves two essential causes. One is creep, of course, creep of the clays, and the experimental evidence available on creep for so long times, many centuries, is very scarce. And in dependence of the model of creep that you put into your computation, you can get very different results. So this is an uncertainty. Second uncertainty is that the tower is subjected to a cyclic fluctuation, for instance, of the water table, of the insulation, and so on. And this cyclic solicitation give contributors to the increase of the settlement with a phenomenon known as, I don't remember the English word, that a continuous repetition of a cycle of stress produces an increase.
This fatigue, a fatigue, like fatigue.
Yes. Now, the behavioral tower is so dependent on small variation that it's difficult to make a quantitative prediction. But indeed, in the position as it was 25 years ago, the tower was on the verge of failure. And naturally, in the because the instability of equilibrium, as we know, produces sudden failures, there was a strong danger. This is what I can see. Of course, how strong in our committee, we try to produce a prediction of the time needed for a failure. And the prediction varies between some tens of years, 70, 80 years, to a couple of centuries. This was the range that we were in.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Claudia?
Yes, I would like just to read this question by Nader Alime. He was wondering to know about something more about in case of earthquake. What do you think, Carlo?
I start, as usual, with a nice story. We asked two very important academic persons in the field of seismology to do a prediction of the most dangerous earthquake that can be expected in Pisa. They did this and did some more. They tried also to say the consequence of this earthquake on the tower. And they discovered that an earthquake with a return period of 60 years would produce the failure of the tower. So this for us was terrific because we had to put this report in a box and not opening it. Then we tried to find some explanation. One possible is that the main source of earthquakes in Pisa is starts from the Apennine range. And so it arrives in Pisa in east-west direction, that is much less dangerous than the north-south direction. This could be one explanation. But again, the tower is very the danger of earthquakes is very important, but the tower has now more than 800 years of life. So this is a fact. And the earthquakes have been during this period, there have been many earthquakes, and the tower is still there.
Thanks. There is, I think, a clarification asked by Alessandro Valente. Why the correction has been set to 0.5 degree and not more? So why have you stopped the correction to 0.5 degree?
Yeah, again, the answer is very strange, and I apologize in advance. When Polvani Commission produced the competition in the request for the competition, there was the inclination of the tower could be decreased, but no more than 1 degree. This was at the time in 65. We said, but why 1 degree? We can do less. It's much better if we do less. And so we said half a degree. This is the only reason why we choose half a degree. We could have chosen a little bit more. Of course, many computers have worked very long for predicting the increase of stability. But in this case, essentially for the reason I have just touched, that any further progress toward the possible collapse would be very slow, would give us time enough to repeat the intervention, we choose the half a degree as a minimum necessary.
Thank you. Claudia?
I would like to say that this without even touch.
I think we have lost Claudia. We have lost Claudia. Okay. Okay, let's wait for Claudia. I would like to know a comment about what was the most difficult part of your experience, of this experience? The most difficult part of this experience for you?
For me, I must confess, was after having conceived the intervention to
to implement it. This was tremendous. I had a nightmare that I was on the Piazza dei Miracoli with one of my hand on the tower talking with someone, and suddenly the tower was missing. I was missing the tower. And it seems a joke. It is truly now after 20 years I am living this nightmare, but the idea to pass to the history as one of the men who destroyed the tower was a very bad idea.
I could imagine. And the easiest part, the unexpected easiest part.
The easiest part was unexpectedly, also because of what I said before of my approach to the structural engineers, was the extreme harmony that they were in our committee. This was probably most due to our fantastic chairman, Michele Jamiolkowski, who was very able to collect the contribution of all. But it was an experience. We have developed the personal contact, very important. Some of my best friends have been done during this war. It's been a fantastic experience.
Okay.
As I say, the mostly merit of Professor Michele Jamiolkowski.
Okay, thank you. Claudia, would you like to try a question? Are you able? No, I think she's having huge problems.
This question of Claudia probably was very difficult. So
no, I don't think so. Okay, maybe the last one, since we are late, 20 minutes late on the schedule, but it is another comment from the audience. If the question is the effect of the correction has been evaluated on the tower structures in terms of stress changes? This is a structural question. So what the amount of reduction in stresses in the tower due to the correction?
The reduction of stress is very small, but indeed, of course, is in the positive sense. So there is a reduction of stress, very small. But the tower also, from the structural viewpoint, was on the verge of failure. In the most dangerous section, that is the section between the base cylinder and the first loggia with columns, because there the resisting section of the tower diminishes strongly, abruptly. In that section, the stress was near to zero from the north side, very near to become traction. And so the tower in some way is a solid isoresistant. The structural failure and the geotechnical failure are practically coincident.
Okay.
What is very interesting, perhaps you have noted when I showed the diagram of the increase of inclination, that there are two lines slightly diverging, because one is the inclination measured at the top of the tower, and the other is measured at the base of the tower. And that of the top is slightly larger, and the difference is continuously increasing. This means that the tower inflects when the increase produces a load normal to the axis that produces an inflection of the tower. I tried to do very rough computation. And this structural deformation is rather important, as the body of the tower is more deformable than one would suggest. This could be a point to deepen, of course.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you again. Very, very interesting also, the last question. So I don't think Claudia, she's frozen again. So John, do you have further question or comments?
Sorry, no, I don't have a question. I just appreciate Dr. Vigiana taking the time to speak to us today. Excellent presentation.
Okay, so I would conclude and close this very interesting IABC webinar with Professor Emeritus Carlo Vigiani. I would thank again Professor Vigiani and all the also John Danteman, Maria Pia Limongelli, and Claudia Vitone for the presentation and to be the moderator with me. Thanks a lot. And bye-bye to all the participants. Thank
may
you.
May I also thank you for the honor you gave to me for inviting me to this one. Thank you.
It was our honor and our pleasure.
Absolutely.
Bye-bye. Bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.